الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أما بعد فإن أحسن الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وإن شر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة بالنار أما بعد. Today my dear brothers and sisters, we're going to be talking about more of having hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And indeed, the hope, having hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, have different kinds and different levels and different ways to approach Him. Today we're going to be touching on one of the most critical aspects. And while I'm saying this, I want you to classify yourself. You know, it's very important because, you know, there is one, it's one thing to listen to a speech, as we, many of us would do, but there's a whole different level for us to kind of know where we're standing. Because there is no point for us to know what are the levels and memorize them and know the kinds of raja yet, and we don't know where we're standing as far as that. So indeed, ya akhwan, having hope with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have different levels that are not the same. That's not the same at all. The scholars have classified the kinds of raja into three kinds. Three kinds of hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They said two of them is praised upon, it's good. And one is looked down upon, something that is not good. So now let's talk about the very first two kinds of having raja in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, having hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said the very first kind of raja, it's the hope of the individual when he commits good deeds and go forth about doing good deeds, and what he's expecting or he having hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would accept from him, you know. So, and this is according to some scholars, considered to be one of the best kinds. You know, الرجل عمل بطاعة الله على نور بالله ويرجو ثواب الله. A man who does a good deed with the light and the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he is begging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he would expect a reward from him. And that's one kind of the good kinds of having hope. So this is one kind, okay? The second kind of having hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one as a person who commits sin. وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ. But what happened? After he commits a sin, you know, he felt bad of what he did. He regretted what he have done. He went back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he seeked tawbah with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he's what? He's asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he would forgive him. You know, the scholar said, وَرَجُلٌ أَذْنَبَ ذَنْبًا ثُمَّ تَاب يَرُجُوا مَغْفِرَةَ اللَّهِ وَمَحْوَ الذُّنُوبَ وَتَجَاوَزُ عَنْهَا وَسِتْرِ عَنْهَا. He committed a sin and he so felt bad for what he's doing. He's going back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, he wanted to seek the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, he wanted Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not only to accept his forgiveness, but also to cover his sins. You know, so these are the very first two kinds of hope that is praised upon. It's something that people look good. It's the kind of hopes that is good. Now the third kind of hope or raja from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that it's looked down upon and it's something that is not good. And not a Muslim should be having this kind of raja. What is this kind of raja? He said, فَرَجَاءُ الرَّجُلِ الْمُتَمَادِّ فِي التَّفْرِيطِ بِالْمَعَاصِي. It is the hope of a man who went forth and continue about committing a sin, you know, وَالسَّيِّئَاتِ وَالْمَعَاصِي, and he committing sins and left and right, and he's collecting all sort of سيئات, he's curling, and above all of that, وَيَرُجُوا رَحْمَةَ اللَّهِ. And what happened at the end of the day? He's like, oh Allah, forgive me. Oh Allah, forgive me based on what? You know, oh Allah, forgive me based on, like, what have you done to change your status? You know, and they say, you know, وَهَذَا الْغُرُورُ وَهَذَا الْغُرُورُ وَتَمَنُّنْ وَرِجَاءٌ كَذَّابٌ. He said, this is a very horrific way of expecting the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this man is arrogant You know, he's arrogant. Based on what you're expecting the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what you have done to undo your sins, you know. And the scholars, he said, and this is this kind of individual, he's a liar. He's a liar because what? You know, it is, you know, for once to commit sins and collectively committing sin, and he's going forth and not really regarding what he's doing, you know. He said, this is not a sincere person who's going back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Abu Uthman al-Huayri, this is what he said. He said what? He said, min alamat al-sa'ada. Who is a person who's truly happy, who's truly successful? Look at what this scholar said. Who is the man who's truly happy and truly successful? أن تطيع وتخاف ألا يقبل. He said that you follow the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you are afraid that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might not accept. Ya Allah. You follow and you strive and you make qiyam al-layl and you fast and you make tasbih and you come to the masjid. And he said, will Allah accept? You know, that's the person who's truly happy, who's truly successful. And he said, وعلامة الشقاق, and a person who is a loser, you know, who is he? أن تعصي وترجو أن تنجو. He said, the one who commits sins and go about committing the sins and he's hoping that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to save him. How is that going to happen? How is that going to work? It's not going to happen. You know, ya ikhwan, is all of us are committers of sin. All of us. None of us are innocent. But the question is, you know, وَخَيْرُ الْخَطَّعُونَ التَّوَابِينَ, that the best of the people who commit sins is the one that go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Regret what they're doing, you know. It stops. Or at least attempt to stop, you know. Like for instance, يعني, subhanallah, يعني, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one of the things that shows you how the door of mercy is open to us. يخي, just have an intention at least. He said, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, وَإِنْ عَادَ لِلذَّنْبِ سَبْعِينَ مَرَّةً فِي الْيَوْمِ. He said, even if a man committed a sin 70 times in one day, and he went back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to accept. But yakhi, be sincere. That's all what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has asked of you, that you said, okay, I'm going to stop. I'm going to, I regret what I'm doing. I'm not going to do it again. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to accept. But the point is that the attitude of carelessness, that's what put people in danger. The attitude of carelessness, or I'm gonna do whatever I wanna do regardless of what people say. That's what put people in danger. I'm gonna be naked and I don't care what people say. I'm gonna put my makeup on and I don't care what people say. I'm going to miss prayer and I don't care what people say. And I'm gonna continue doing what I'm doing. And that's the stubborn. What gets people in stubborn, the anid, the people who are stubborn and who gets people in trouble, and that's what people gets people in trouble. Now we're gonna go into this question that I want to ask you guys. You know, the scholars have asked this question. Okay, the scholars have asked this question: which one is better? Okay, number one in the kinds of raja, or number two? The scholars, they asked the question. We said the very first two types of raja are good, right? The scholars, they say, which one is better? Number one, the person who commit good deeds. And he's hoping that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to accept his good deeds. Or the person who committed a sin and he's regretting. And he committed tawbah that he's going to go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Which one is better? Number one, okay. Actually, the scholars have differed. some scholars said number one is good, you know. Yeah, and some scholars they said number two is good. He said, why they said number one is good? For the scholars, number one is good. The person who go about committing good deeds and he's hoping the acceptance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, because he's doing good things. You know, he's not committing any sin. And on top of that, because of his humbleness, he's asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept. But the other ones, the scholars said, number two, the person who committed a sin and he's asking for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness and he went about and he made tawbah. He said, why number two is better? He said, because number two is humble. He submitted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He changed. Because thing is, change is huge. Yeah. You know, because for someone to change, it's a big step. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves tawbah, exactly. But some of the scholars, they said, this is what they said. And this is something that I want you guys to understand. Is they said that, and the two have a situation in all of us. And the two, number one and number two, have a situation in all of us. They said that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have given you an opportunity to do good deeds, then after you do it and you strive about doing it, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept, you know. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have tested you to commit a sin, repent and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive you. And which human being does not fall into one of these two? All of us. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enabled you to do good deeds, don't be arrogant. Just because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enabled you, that doesn't mean that you look down on other people. I am the sheikh, I am the who and who, I am the... No, it doesn't work that way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have blessed you. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have given you the guidance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enabled you to do such a good thing. So with this, humble yourself. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he might accept. And if Allah and if you commit a sin, and who among us has not committed a sin? Repent. Go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Beg him. Submit to him. Cry. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves those who cry and submit themselves and humiliate themselves to them. And ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. And again, who does not fall in one of these two? All of us are fallen to one of these two categories at one point in our lives. Now, so these are the kinds of having hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now the question is this, ya akhwan. Now, the raja, having hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, come in three levels. Just like there is kinds in three, the levels of raja, there is three levels, okay? And let's start with a very basic level, okay? Which is the basic level? Like this, here we're talking about the lowest level of raja. And I want you guys to compare yourself and let me compare myself with this kind of level and see where we're standing. He said, it is the kind of raja that pushes the individual to have hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that they want to increase in the amount of good deeds that they're doing. You know, for instance, when someone, if you are a merchant or somebody who is trying to make money, and they know the reward or they know how much money that they're going to be making, wouldn't you strive for that profit? Wouldn't you strive to gain, to do more? You know, wouldn't you strive to make more money? The same thing, because, you know, for instance, a merchant, he spends the nights trying to travel. If a person who wants to make money, he might stay away from his family. You know, he spends maybe long hours, you know, with work, right? For what? Why all the struggle? Because he knows the reward. You see? That's the key. He's hoping of the reward that is going to come. You see? And the same thing when someone is traveling toward Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He go about committing good things, you know. He knows Salat al-Fajr is difficult, but he knows the reward of coming to Salat al-Fajr. He knows that, you know, it's difficult sometimes to make wudu in the winter, but he knows the reward of making wudu early in the morning. He knows that it's difficult. And it's time consuming, and it takes a lot of money to make Umrah or Hajj, but yet he knows the reward of Umrah and Hajj. He knows it's difficult for him to seek more knowledge, and it's time consuming to sit in these halaqat, but yet he sacrifices time and he because he wants to learn more knowledge. He knows it's difficult to stand up straight making Qiyam al-Layl, but he sacrifices because he knows the reward. Yeah, he knows the value. Yes, he knows it's difficult for him to make siyam and for him to keep himself away from the food. But when he knows that he knows the reward of fasting and etc., you see. So that's why the person who is the very first lower level of having hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that have a hope that pushes him to do good deeds, because he knows the reward of all the good deeds that he's doing, and he goes about doing that and he strives because what? Because he's expecting the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's hoping of the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And subhanallah, when someone strives, initially it's harsh on the soul, but after a while he would taste the beauty of it. Initially, I'm going to be honest with you, initially it's tough to make qiyam al-layl and fast and make sadaqah and lower your gaze. Wallahi, it's difficult. Wallahi, it's so hard. Don't think it's easy. But later on, you would taste the beauty of it after doing it for some times. One of the scholars, he said, and wallahi, I love this saying. He said, كَابَتُ قِيَامَ اللَّيْلِ 20 سَنَةً ثُمَّ تَنَعَّمْتُ بِهِ 20 سَنَةً. He said, I have strived. It was harsh for me to make qiyam al-layl for 20 years. 20 years I was pushing myself, striving. It was difficult. He said, and the next 20 years, it was so beautiful. It was pleasure. It was soothing on the heart. He enjoyed it. It was like tasting honey, you know? And that's subhanAllah, and that's the issue. The thing is, many of us, because we're not used to doing this, it's difficult on us. It's harsh on our soul. But once you see the beauty of it, and then you see the after effects of it, wallahi, it becomes so soothing, and you would taste the beauty of it, you know. And subhanallah, when someone, you know, for instance, when someone, like I said, when someone tastes the beauty of gaining the reward, making sadaqah, when he tastes the beauty of making sadaqah, he would be able to give up the money like this. He does not care, because he knows. He knows, like, when I give sadaqah, I have tasted the beauty of it. He would give up his wealth, and he does not even care. When someone tasted the beauty of fasting, he would leave the food and the drink. He does not care, because he tasted the beauty of it. When somebody tastes the beauty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala testing him, for instance, he will become patient, and patience become easy on him, and etc. Subhanallah. So the thing is, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us the taste, the beauty of doing good deeds. Wallahi, ya akhwan, this is an honor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave only to certain individual, you know. For subhanallah, so يعني وأعظم يعني ولا يترك المحبوب إلا لمحبوب أعظم منه. And someone does not leave something that he loves unless he gives it up to someone that he loves it more. And we love who's more? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's okay. So if your ultimate goal is the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you would give up everything that you love. Whether it was wealth, whether it was sleep, whether it was, you know, money, and etc. You know, so that's the very first level in which that you are here, striving to do what? Good deeds. The drive here is what? The hope of the reward of the good deeds. Okay, that's level number one. Now look at how, what is level two in the hope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said that people in this level would give up bad habits. Here we're not talking about haram, you understand? So see, here we're talking about bad habits, not haram. Like, for instance, wasting your time, you know, like something that is not actively haram, a sin, you know. It's just a not good habit, you know, whether it was chatting with friends, whether it was reading fiction books, that is not haram, you know. Whether it was anything that is could waste your time, but it's considered to be a bad habit. But the person on this level, now he's already there. He's already committing good deeds, you know. He's already expecting the reward. But what happened? He want to do some more. So he, what happened? He exchanged these not so good habits with something is better. And he cannot, the scholars say, he cannot do so unless he have the knowledge. You see? How? Because thing is, now when you have knowledge, you know what, you not only know what halal and haram, you know what is more priority. Yeah, you see? So the thing is, like for instance, let me give you an example. You know, sometimes we face with many times with two halal. But which one is better to do it at this time? Sometimes you are faced with two good things. But which one have the more priority to do it versus another? You know? You see? So this, and how would somebody was able to do so? Except with what? With knowledge. You know, so that's why in this level, no one can be in this level unless he have more knowledge. Because what? He could judge which one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would like more, A or B. Both of them is halal, you know, but one of them, which one is more lovable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He's running after his hope is how can I get, what can I do? Something that is better, you know, you see what I'm saying? And over time, what happened? He would erase all his bad habits with something good. Like for instance, someone who may be busy with social media. He wastes hours and hours. Sometimes maybe it could not be haram what he's doing, but maybe he exchange it with maybe reading good books, you know, reading Quran, you know, and etc. You know, so the thing is, again, this stuff comes with knowledge and changing some of your bad habits. And so this is level number two. Level number three, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among these people, you know. This is a level that, yani, very, very few people on earth that could reach that level, you know. And this is something that, yani, I'm hoping there's still people who could exist in earth that could fit this level. But let's talk about it and see some examples of the Sahaba that have reached this level. رجاء أرباب القلوب للقاء الخالق والاشتياق إليه سبحانه وتعالى. He said this level is a person is willing to give up everything in his life for the sake of meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For the hope of meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يعني whether it was, you know, kids, money, he's like, you know, and this is like one of the highest level of zuhd. You know, this guy is zahid. Like he's even mystical. You know, like he's giving everything in his life, and his only hope: how can I meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about this in the Quran. فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ فَمَنْ كَانَ what? يَرْجُو رجاء. فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا. Whoever have a hope in meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so let him do good deeds and would not associate anything with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said also, مَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو لِقَاءَ اللَّهِ فَإِنَّ أَجَلَ اللَّهِ لَآتٍ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. Whoever have hope in meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, indeed, the meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is indeed gonna be coming. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all-hearing, all-knowing. So this is the rajaa al-luqya, that you have hope in meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're willing to give up anything in your life for what? For you to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is subhanallah, yani this type of people, their heart are shivering. Always, the only thing in their mind is how can I hope Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? In what situation am I going to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? When I'm going to meet him, committing good things or not, you know? And he's willing to give up everything in this dunya for that sake, you know? And I'm going to give you a story that puts you close to this reality, you know? It's a story of a sahabi. His name is Umayr bin Humam al-Ansari, okay? So this story happened in the Battle of Badr. What happened? You know, this man, Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, he heard Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم saying, "قوموا إلى جنة عرضها السماوات والأرض." Like all people, Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم was encouraging the people. Oh, you believe? Get up for a heaven that is as wide as the heavens and the earth. You know, so Umayr ibn Ansari, he said, Jannatun, arduha as-samawati wal-ard. Like, oh, Prophet of Allah, you talk about a Jannah that is as big as the heavens and the earth? Rasulullah said, yes. He said, bakhin, bakhin. He said, whoa, like, bakhin, bakhin in Arabic mean like, what a great thing. How could we miss this thing? So Prophet said, why are you saying that? Why are you saying that? He said, He said, Oh Rasulullah, I hope, inni arju an akuna min ahliha. Oh Prophet of Allah, I hope that I become one of the inhabitants, one of the people who enter this Jannah that is as wide as the earth. Prophet ﷺ gave him the glad tidings immediately. He said, فَإِنَّكَ مِنْهَا. You are from them. Subhanallah. Immediately. The answer came immediately. You are from them. Subhanallah. So this man, this is what he did. He had few dates. You know, back then, lunch and their dinner is made out of dates. That's it. You know, they take 3 days and lunch and 3 days and dinner. And that was enough. So he had like few dates in his bucket. He said, Wallahi, and look what he said, Wallahi, it's such a long time to enter this Jannah, you know, eating these dates. I don't have time. He throwed the dates. He said, because I am so anxious to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I am so anxious to enter into this heaven. I don't have time enough to even eat these dates. It's going to take a long time for me to eat these dates, you know, subhanallah. He threw these dates, you know, and he went on fighting in this battle. And he was among the martyrs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And subhanallah, yeah, this is like, look, this is, yeah, subhanallah, yeah, subhanallah, yeah, this is how people have, yeah, this is the level that, yeah, and he's willing to give up anything. Like, yeah, subhanallah, yeah, if you ask any of us, like, is it haram for him to eat these dates? No. But look, the level of anxiousness that this person had. Yeah, he could not wait. He could not even wait for him to eat. Subhanallah, even though it maybe 5 minutes. But his anxiety and his love toward Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his hope in meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was above all of that. And he's gave up everything for the meeting of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For subhanallah, this is the kind of people that they're so focused in this life. You know, their life is, how can I do this so I can speed in my meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? In what situation I'm going to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Oh, I'm going to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is happy with me, you know? So you would not have this individual ask if this is halal or haram. This person would not even ask if this is mustabah or makruh. He would follow anything that is given to him. Anything that is being, if he heard of a small sunnah, he would jump into it. If he heard any order of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would go into it. He would like, oh, because many of us now, you know, there was like, oh, is this sunnah? Oh, I'm not going to do it, you know. We have this attitude, you know, as if it's sunnah, then you're free from doing it. Subhanallah, yani, where is the love of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know? Of course, yeah. So it really depends in the amount of love that you have toward your Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, toward Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, "Man kana yarju liqa'a rabbihi falyamal 'amalan salihan." Whoever hope that he's going to meet his Lord, so let him do good deeds and let him associate anything with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So with this, ya akhwan, we talked about the different kinds of raja, different levels of raja. Inshallah, next week, we're going to be talking about how could we deal with raja and committing sins. Inshallah, next week, within Allah Ta'ala. If I said anything that is good, is it from Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala and His Prophet? If I said anything inappropriate for myself and the shaytan, jazakum al khair, hustu ma'akum subhanaka, wa hamdika nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk wal asr, inna linsana lafi khusr, illa ladhina amnu wa amlu salihati wa tawasaw bil haqqi wa tawasaw bil sabr, jazakum Allah khair. May Allah accept and may Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala reward all of you.